Hey everyone, welcome to Inner Shaolin, and we have a really big treat for you. We're going to do the first part of the Silm Tao breakdown for you. Sifu is going to share all kinds of goodies with you. You're probably going to see some things about Silm Tao and learn some things about Silm Tao that you've never learned before. So without further ado, Sifu Fu.
Hey everyone, couple things I want to say. One, I'm getting over a cold, so I'm going to do my best to speak to you loudly. But if you can't hear me, just let me know and I'll do my best to speak louder. Secondly, if I do cough, forgive me, I'm getting over a cold. Okay, so this webinar is gonna be a breakdown of the Silm Tao. And really what we're gonna work on is the breakdown of the body mechanics in it. How to improve yourself through it, how to project your energy properly, where do you rely on using your muscular strength versus using your tendons, where you should place your energy in certain motions, how the body should be aligned properly. All this we're going to work on. This series will take anywhere from maybe 10 to 12, maybe longer. I'm going to do a complete breakdown for you guys to help you better understand what you're doing. Also, I want to let you know that I'm not here to say whatever system of Wing Chun you're doing that you're doing it wrong, but my way is the right way. If you say, well, this is not how I learned it from my teacher, this works for me, that's great. There's more than one way to do movements and energy. But it's for those who have problems to say, listen, I always have problems when I pack someone, and every time I pack, I always feel the energy come back to me. I always have to throw hard, and no matter how hard I throw, this big guy's always hurting my arms. I can't really move as well. This is to help you learn. You don't have to worry about the size, you don't have to worry about the strength. Most of the time, it's because your energy projection is wrong. It's because of your balance. So I'm going to work with you on how to develop your proper energy, okay, through structural integrity. That's important to have. And you also have to have balance in your motion, because you can throw a lot of energy into something. If you're off balance, you're going to wind up tipping over or falling over or overcommitting things, okay? Or if you throw a lot of energy, your guy's just a lot strong, he's going to plow you down. Or if you play somebody who's skilled, who's got a lot of skill, and you put a lot of energy, he's just going to counter you with the technique. So we're going to work on developing forward energy, which is what we call forward intent, through structural integrity. And we're going to work on developing balance and knowing how to keep the energy proper. So this way, no matter how big, no matter how strong someone is, size should not be a factor. Okay? Anyone who says it is a factor, that's because they don't know how to handle someone bigger, and they have to use their size to make it work. Chinese are saying 4 ounces can move 1,000 pounds. You just need to know how. And so we're going to break down the way the body works and teach you how to get better. Now, obviously, you know, 20,000 pound guy who's 80 foot tall obviously is going to crush you no matter how much your skill level is, because your structural integrity and your ability to move would not be able to beat his, because he's that much bigger, that much stronger, but there's nobody that big, okay? We're all within a certain range, and your technique through the energy projection will make the difference, okay? So a guy who's like, say, 300 pounds, and you're 125 pounds, it's not that much of a difference in the grand scheme of things if you know how to use your energy control and energy projection. So just to let you know, like I said, I'm gonna break it down, and it's gonna be really, really detailed for you guys. Okay, and this is going to help you, like I said, better understand. So we're going to use the Silm Tao as a platform, and because I don't know your form, we're going to use ours as a platform. So if you go, well, I don't do it in this specific order, it doesn't matter. It's really not the order, it's matter the manner in which you move, okay? So if you move a certain way, or we do this this many times, we do this that many times, that's fine. If you do Fook 5 times versus the other style does 2 times, it doesn't matter. The question is, how are you doing it? And that's what we're gonna work on, the hows, okay? And the other thing I wanna let you know is when we're done, we're gonna have this made into a series for you guys. So if you guys are interested in buying the series, it's gonna be there for you guys as well. For those who are members, first off, hi, welcome, thank you for coming. And it's going to be there for you guys because you're a member of our site, so you're going to have it, so you don't have to worry about it, and you'll have it for you at all times as you're a member. For those who haven't seen it, you'll get to see it after for another few days, and then we're going to take it off air. So I hope you guys enjoy this. This is basically how your energy works through the Know.Now system. I'm going to use the Wing Chun Soul Tao platform to show you how to enhance yourself. Okay? So first thing we want to remember, why we do our forms. What's the purpose in doing our forms? Forms are basically designed for a few things. One, develop muscle memory to teach you how to move without thought. By repetitious movement, your body will naturally move a specific way instinctively. So if you get a habit, for example, like doing this and like this, and you do that 1,000 times, you're gonna naturally do that, okay? So the forms are designed to teach you how to move specific ways to deal with combat, to deal with energy and all that stuff, okay? So that's the important thing of why we wanna do a form. The second thing is your technique lies in your forms. So everything you could learn on how to handle certain types of strikes from distance, what type of strikes, they're all in your form. So the techniques lies in your form. That's why we practice our forms. So we do that for that purpose. And the third reason why we do it is to condition the body. Okay, there's specific ways of training the body besides just training for muscle memory. We can train you to do explosive techniques, intensity techniques, and we use our forms as a build-up tool. And the other reason that learning forms is a good thing is if you have nobody to practice with, that's a great way to practice, because it's developing your body, how to move, how to develop physicality, and teach you techniques at the same time. So doing a form is very good for those reasons. I know that Bruce Lee hated it. He just didn't have the patience. He's like, I don't want to stand here and mimic someone else's movement. I want to do my own. And that's fine. If you're that type of person, that's fine. Maybe forms aren't for you. But for those who don't have that prowess like Bruce Lee had, that they want to just go out and just do whatever he can, and you need a stepping stone to build from, forms are great. I love forms. I practice it like 3-4 hours all the time. I should say, I practice forms about an hour. I did 3-4 hours of training, but an hour of forms, okay? And because it helped me perfect my techniques. It was one of the reasons why I got very precise, very sharp, and I started growing, learning how to, because I could feel my energy through it. So that's why we're gonna do our forms, okay? And I'm gonna use Soul Tao, because this works in all forms. If you're a Hungar, if you're karate, if you're any kind of style that does repetitious forms, these principles will apply to any one of them, okay? So you're gonna follow principles today, not necessarily the movements, but I'm gonna teach you how to apply those movements with these principles to help you get better, okay? So one of the rules you wanna remember is what we call highest heaven, lowest earth. Highest heaven means stand as tall as you possibly stand. Lowest earth means to relax the body as much as you can. And the reason why we wanna do that is because we don't want to create a slouch, okay? Highest heaven is to create a proper posture from our backside, from our hips to our head. And the reason why that's important is because if we create a slouch in our body, like a bow on a stick, when I bend it, where's the pressure going? It's gonna go to where the bow is. So as you start pushing the top to the bottom down on a stick, it wants to snap and all the pressure goes towards the side, okay? So the reason why we wanna make sure we have that, because everything that we do now at highest heaven can affect the whole entire body, not the specific point where we bow. So I'm gonna show you an example of difference of how just the posture makes it. So I'm gonna bring in Hector, and I'm gonna show you just the difference. And if I hold my body like this, and he's gonna push into me, and I have this slouch, he pushes in, it's gonna break through that. And my body, because of the bow, you can see if I naturally create a slouch in my body, you can see where the bow goes in. So my energy wants to have a propensity to go there. And same thing for my leg, it's gonna wanna uproot the lift and go there. If I can stand upright, push in me, now I have the ability to drive pressure back. If I do the same thing, I do this, even if I try to push, all the pressure I'm trying to return him is actually gonna go to me. And the reason why is, what's the fundamental principle of energy? It wants to go to the path of least resistance. So if my posture is like this, the slouch I have, that's the path of least resistance. So even if I'm good at driving my arms and throw my weight, it wants to go here, because that's the nature of energy. But if I just go like this, and you can see how he's gonna push into me, but if I just, it changes everything, okay? He has a hard time, but And you can see it starts to collapse. So we want that highest heaven for that purpose. We want to create a proper structure so it doesn't feed into our body. Okay? So that's highest heaven. Lowest earth. What is lowest earth? Lowest earth, that means you sink into the ground with your knees and everything. Lowest earth is so we can relax our shoulders, keep the arms down, let our knees bend so our feet feel the ground. It's so we can get to the ground, be grounded, okay? So we want lowest earth so we can find the floor, because without the floor, we can't project energy. Imagine if I'm going on the same thing again, right? And I start going like this, and imagine I was on figure skates or ice skates, I would slide backwards because I can't connect to the ground, okay? I can't get my root into the ground because of that. So we want lowest earth. So imagine if I was like this. I don't have a root. You see, I'm on my tippy toes, and I want to go like this, okay? Now, if it works for you and you can say, hey, I train myself, I'll hop around, that's fine. If that's the way you work and you would compensate the lack of root by cutting angles, it's fine. As long as you find your counterforce to where you're off one side, you have a counterforce to balance that out. That works for you. That's great. But lower earth is so you can learn how to not always have to move. So instead of having to move away from him, I can have him move away from me. So I don't have to make that extra effort to dance around. I can learn how to take the opponent's force and have him just move around me instead of me going around him. Now, as I said, again, if that's your option, that's fine. For those who don't have the energy, if you're older, if you're not as big, not as strong, not as fast, this is the other option, okay? And it takes less energy, by the way, to have to do this. The offset is, like I said, the counter, is it takes more technique, though. It does take more control. It takes more ability to control the opponent's energy as opposed to move away from someone's energy, okay? So we're going to talk about that principle, highest heaven, lowest earth, okay? The second principle I want you to understand is there are three points of drive you got to project, and this is how you generate foreign energy to your opponent, okay? This will teach you what we call structural integrity. What is structural integrity? Structural integrity is the manner in which you hold yourself without straining the body. Understand that the body is allowed to feel stress, okay? We're always under stress from living on the earth with gravity pushing us down, our body's pushing against it. Otherwise, we go to the center of the earth, okay? So we're always under stress. You're okay, you're allowed to feel stress. Your body's made to handle stress, but you're not allowed to strain, okay? Straining is struggling to hold your position. For example, if I'm like this, okay, and he grabs my wrist and he pushes my elbow to bend it, bend my elbow if you can. So if I'm like this, and you see my shoulder go up, can I bend it? Look. Now I can't hold because I'm straining. Do it again. If I project forward energy, right, I can feel pressure, but I'm not straining for him, okay? He's straining, I'm not. You can hear it in my voice. I'm not going like this, but this is easy. I'm not straining. You understand? I'm not straining at all. I can feel the stress, but it's not straining because I have the right structural integrity, okay? So the structural integrity is very important because it allows you to handle stress and develop how to receive pressure, okay? And the third thing is you can feel the structural integrity is so you can apply pressure back to the opponent. So without it, if I'm like this, raising my shoulders and I lift my elbow, I have to throw more strength. If I can align everything in here, now my structure helps me generate better power, so I don't have to throw more body weight. I don't have to throw my momentum or throw my shoulder into it or use more straining, you know, more muscles to throw. I can generate just by lining my body, natural intention, and forward intentions, and drive that to my point. So we want to develop that structural integrity because that's what allows us to handle stress, allows us to put pressure on the opponent. Okay, so that's what we want to develop. The three rules of driving, I'm sorry about my throat, by the way, is Shoulder was always drive to the elbow. Okay, that's your first drive. Your second drive is the drive is always from the elbow to the wrist. Must have that. Your third is your wrist must always turn to whatever the point of target is. So depending on where I make contact, that's where I gotta turn my energy. Okay, for example, if I go like this, let me use this hand. If I have the turning of the wrist, but no drive pushing me, it'll collapse. Okay, if I have the drive, which I mean, I can hold structure, but he can still overpower me and overwhelm me. Together, pushing me hard. Hard. So you see, I am able to manipulate him without having to fight him. My forward intentions between my first shoulder to the elbow to the wrist, is so I can develop, like I said, structure. It allows me to put pressure to my opponent. However, what happens if the guy's stronger than me? What happens three times my size? That's where the third part comes in, the wrist. The wrist must turn to the point of contact. So let's say I'm here, okay? That's what I use this side because it's easy. So if I'm here and he pushes into me and I turn towards the hand still, it will work because that's not where the contact is. Pushing me, I turn the wrist into the point of contact. That's how I influence. So if he pushes and I go this, I can't influence him, I'll break. If I do it like this, you can see I went under. If I turn my wrist to point, you can see I can control it. Okay, so we wanna have that drive, like I said, and we made videos on YouTube too, so if you wanna see further explanation of that, it's there for you too. So it's very important to have this, what I call the first floor. This is the second floor. This is your third floor. You can't have the wrist without the support of the elbow. Can't have the elbow support without the shoulder supporting that. Okay? So you can't have a third floor without a second floor. You can't have a third floor without a first floor. Yeah, I can have a second floor if you have a first floor. You can have a third floor if you have a second floor. And so you gotta think, your drive is always from your shoulder to the elbow, elbow to the wrist, wrist turns to the point of contact. Okay, so that's very important. That is a fundamental rule. You have to. Okay, it's that important. That's why I want to emphasize it. Without it, like I said, okay, what's the purpose of the arm from the shoulder to elbow to elbow? It's your drive. It is what gives you forward intent. It is what gives you the ability to put pressure on your opponent. Okay, but its only function is to drive forward. It's not designed for directional force. It's your wrist job to steer. It's your wrist job to change pressure. It's your wrist job to take pressure off of you. Okay, and that's why your wrist must turn to the point of contact, because no matter where he makes interception, it's my job to influence. If you can see here, I'm turning to the point of contact. Do I look like I'm turning to the point of contact? No. So he could literally punch into me. Punch into me. You can see I turned it to the point of contact. Now he moves. Okay? So it's your wrist job to change angles. It's your wrist job that creates directional force. It's not your arm's job. Your arm's job has only one function only, to drive forward. Your shoulder's job has one function, drive to the elbow. Your elbow job has one function, drive to the wrist. Your wrist job is to turn, and that's the variable. It has to turn where? Depend on where the contact point is, where you need to move it. And that's the variable, okay? So it's really hard concept because a lot of my students don't always get it right because they'll think one thing, forget the other, think the other, then forget the one thing. It's a feel, okay? It's all about feeling. You don't think how to ride a bicycle when you learn how to ride it, you just feel. You don't think how to drive a car, you just go, you just do it. You don't think what you have to say when you want to just say something, you just say it out of your head, okay? Some people don't think enough before they speak, and that's a bad thing, but it's okay right now. Our job is to create this principle, okay? And this is gonna be the underlying principle of your soul and talent. That's why I'm going over this with you, so you can understand But this is your function. This is your focus. This is your finale. This is what you got to get down. Because it doesn't matter what kind of fancy hands you do, like this, it's not gonna work if you don't get your right projection. Do it again. You see? Notice how I hold my drive and I turn my wrist to my point. I'm not driving my wrist to the point. I'm driving my arm against the point. Okay? Remember, your wrist job is to release pressure from the body. Do it again. That's trying to fight. Okay? Without the support of the elbow on the wrist, or the elbow on the shoulder, my wrist can turn all at once, but it'll collapse. So that's very important, okay? So like I said, you have to, and multiply that another 20 times. Have to get those principles down in order to do your soul tap. That's your focus. That's what I want you to mentally develop, that's what you're doing it for, okay? Because if you can do, let's say, a pack sal, and you're going like this, and you have a tendency to drop, has that ever happened to you? Where, let's say, a guy fakes a punch, and you go, it's because you're not right driving the right focus. You're throwing force, but you're not throwing forward energy intent. Okay? So today we're gonna break this down, okay, and help you guys with that. Remember the rule, highest heaven, lowest earth. Very important. So that way you don't have a breakage in your body. That way you can find your connection to the ground. Okay? And then you have your drives out in front of you. Okay? That's important. Now, why does Selim Tal not do the feet? Why does it not have steps and this and that? Because they want you to learn the arms first. A true person who knows their Selim Tal should be able to stand in a horse stance and take any punch that comes at him, apart from a guy cutting an angle where you have to turn to face him. But any attack that comes from you at this point, as he punches you, should be able to handle any pressure attack from this. So when he's doing this, your hands should have no problem. Or if he's pushing you, you should not have a problem directing force. If he grabs you, you shouldn't have to have struggling. You should be able to handle his energy and not worry about his size or strength, because you're never trying to fight his size or strength. You're controlling the point of energy. And how do you do that? By finding your root and finding your forward intent and the balance in it. Okay? So now that we established that, okay, we're going to work on the first part of your form. The very first part of your form, we want to bring our arms up, okay? So let's work on that. So I'm going to have Hector perform that movement. So he's going to start his feet together and have his hands open. And he's going to bring his hands up, okay? So bring his hands up, okay? So let's do that again. And I'm going to just, if you guys do this, this is pressure test control. This is how you can tell if you do it right or wrong. This is how I test my students to see if they're properly projecting energy. Is you just have to take a finger to thumb, rest it on the wrist. Now, I'm not saying take the hardest stance, give him the most highest resistance. He's a beginner. He's not gonna be able to do it right away. Just the lightest test is possible, because the slightest pressure, he's gonna know. If we do it like this, he raises his arms up, he can feel his shoulders. Can you feel his shoulders? Right? So if I did this, and you can resist me, okay? And I go like this, and I try to force it up, okay? You see how he's gonna fall backwards? Because I projected that energy out in front of me. As opposed to using my shoulders, okay? So when you are doing this, you gotta think, drive the shoulder to the elbow, drive the elbow to the wrist, and you're gonna float your wrist up like this, okay? So you're gonna imagine you are not lifting your shoulders to make the hand go up. If you do that, you will throw your shoulders. So if we're going like this, and he does that, and do it the wrong way, please. If I just did this, I'll just stand in the horse stance, and he does it, okay? That wasn't too bad, but you did some wrong too, okay? So do it again, okay? Good. So you can see now he's moving me backwards, okay? What he's doing, like I said, first off, you never, ever, not now, not ever. If you do, it will break. If it doesn't break, I will break it for you. You never lock your joints, okay? So when you lift your arms should never be stiff and locked, okay? There's a few reasons why. One, because I'll break it out before you if it doesn't break, because it will break. Okay, under pressure, someone can break your elbow very easily. So you never lock your joints for that purpose. Second thing is, once you create a locked arm, you put direct stress from whatever you have on your wrist right into the shoulders. So when he lifts up with a straight arm, he's gonna feel a lot of stress. And you guys can do this experiment. You're gonna do that, he's gonna feel that stress, slightly bend your elbow and lift up. He's gonna feel the pressure come off his shoulder. Because this joint here, whatever he feels here, this joint that bends, once it's locked, you disengage basically your tendons, your muscles from lock or from being used. So it's forearm muscles, extensor flexors, triceps, biceps. They're not really engaged anymore. They don't work. His shoulders work, even his wrist works, but this is gone. With a slight bend, he can stimulate his extensor muscles, his flexor muscles, his biceps, his triceps, and use the shoulder not to push this. He uses his shoulder to push the elbow forward. And the elbow itself is gonna flex and drive it to the wrist, and the wrist is gonna come upward, floating like a snake. And if you do that right, you'll find that you can generate way more power and less stress, because you're not gonna fight the motion, you are actually moving the motion. Okay, it's like, and you might go, well, what do you mean, I don't get it. Isn't he still pushing at you? Yes, but you remember, when your stiff arm, it's a lever from the shoulder to the gripping point. So I have a long lever. Think of a wrench with a lug nut. Here's the handle, here's a lug nut. He's gonna put a lot of stress because of this lever here. So when he's bringing it up on a straight arm, that's a lot of stress on his arm. Bend the elbow, okay, bend the elbow, okay? What happens is he's not getting pressure from here to here. He's getting pressure from here to here. And that here, what happens is this shoulder won't feel the pressure as easy, but it can enforce this now. So his shoulder drives up, which helps move the energy forward to the wrist. We said his wrist can turn the energy off. So he's not fighting energy. He's actually learned how to drive forward energy and then moving the energy, the pressure, I should say, as opposed to fighting directly against it. Think of it like this, pushing. He's actually now doing it like this. So he's not getting a direct resistance on someone. He's getting a slightly indirect. He's getting from underneath and getting around it. So he's not getting direct pressure feedback into his body. It's actually an indirect feedback. And that's why his arms can come up with much more power, much more focus, and less stress on his body. Because he's got more muscle groups to help him. He's taking direct pressure off from where this is, from here to here, okay? And now he can drive support, and then his wrist now gets a better feed. Because remember, what holds your hand here? What keeps it stable? Don't move his hand, okay? I call this $1 million theory, okay? And I'll give you $1 million if you can do this. And I've done this before on videos. So you do this at home, okay? And you do this experiment. If you can do it, show me the video, you get $1 million. You gotta keep your hand absolutely steady. It cannot move from that spot, not up, not left, not right, not down, not forward, not backwards. Okay, so he has to keep it steady. You have to let him move your elbow. You have to let the elbow move. So don't move the hand, but you have to let him move the elbow. No, you have to let him move. You cannot fight me with the elbow. No, you can't move the hand. Okay, you're fighting, you can't fight me. So obviously, what's the conclusion? If you move the elbow, your hand will move too. What gives the wrist support? The elbow, okay? What gives your elbow support? The shoulder. And then the wrist, again, based on what he feels, the energy, where the contact point is, it'll do its duty once it makes contact to an opponent, okay? So you have to have that. So when you're floating up, think of that slight bend on your joint, okay? So you don't lock your joints at all. You have a slight bend. And when you think, you wanna think of focusing energy to the back side of your wrist as you go up and forward. So it floats, not gets angled up and lifted like this. That's a lot of stress on the shoulders. So you wanna look like you're floating. And when you do it right, you will feel like it's like, oh my gosh, it does feel different. It does feel like it floats because it's less effort, because you got more muscle groups working for you. You got less stress on the shoulders because you're not getting direct feedback from the weight of the arm. It's less because there's a bend in your joint. So the pressure from here doesn't go here, it goes to here, which gets supported by this, which gives you more strength to go forward. Okay, and that's why we want that, okay? So that's the first thing I need you guys to do. When you bring your hands up, you're gonna bring it up shoulder level. Okay, so you're gonna float it up about shoulder level. Can you go higher? Can you go lower? Within half an inch, that's fine. But shoulder levels are focused. Why not, I'm sorry, why not go up to the eyes? Why can't we go like this, go to the eyes? Once you do this, your energy will start to rock backwards like this, and you don't want that. What's the highest point of your arm? Your shoulders, okay? So in your form, you're just gonna practice that. Can you go higher? Yes, you can, but you have to drive from this position here. You don't wanna lift from this all the way up there. You wanna more float like that, and that's a different story. We wanna keep our chamber in. You know, a snake don't strike his arms like his body like this. He strikes a coil, and that's how it gets its power. And that's how it gets its angle. And that's how it gets its speed. And that's the way we want to do for our going to the eyes. But from a floating standpoint, you don't want to go from here and go up. You'll start to feel that rock backwards, which we don't want to do. So you only want to go about shoulder level. Can you go a little bit higher? Yeah, you can. A little bit lower? Yeah, you can. Within a certain inch or two, that's fine. Okay? But ideally, shoulder level. So first step, shoulder level. And you see my arm, it has a slight bend. You can see my muscles come out from that. You want to think the energy. If you do this right, Hector's going to put his hand on the back of my hand and just two fingers on me. Push me down. Okay? It's very hard for him. I go straight out, push me down. That's another experiment you can do to see if you have the right projection when it comes up. So when Hector does that up, and I just take two fingers and I put it right on his wrist. Don't put it on his fingers. Okay, put it on his wrist because that's where the energy should go. So if I do something like this, after you straighten out your arm, it's easy. Joke. Nothing. Big baby. Okay, so we don't want to lock that joint out because you can just do the pressure test. And pressure test is, like I said, it's here for you to see if you're doing it right or wrong. Are you straining? Is your body under stress or is it straining? Stress is okay. I feel stress when he pushes me down. I'm not straining. It doesn't bother me. Okay? Now, what happens if a guy puts 10,000 pounds of pressure on you? Well, I wouldn't be there. I'd move out of the way. Or I move it out of the way if I possible. Or I get out of the way. So that's another story. Okay? We'll talk about principles of energy later. Right now, we're going to teach you structural integrity and how to get your optimal energy out. Okay? And this is the way to do it. Optimal energy. Most amount of power, least amount of effort, okay? So that's our first thing. So when we do this, first rule, we're gonna go up, shoulder width, shoulder height, okay? Next stage, you're gonna turn your wrists, turning your palms to the sky, okay? If you look at my hand, you don't wanna go like this and flip-flop it. You don't wanna go like this and turn it and let it pull itself off the line. Our goal is think of where your pinky is and your thumb is. Put your thumb where your pinky is. Put your pinky where your thumb is. Right in the center of your palm is where your pivoting point is. Okay? And you want to not just turn your hand. There's no life in your wrists. Turning your hand is just turning your hand. But if I do this, can you do me a favor? When I turn my hand, just push my arm down. So just here. So when I turn my hand, you're going to push my arm down. Okay, so when I do this and I turn my hand like this, can you push it down? Of course, there's no life in my wrist. Do it again. You can't, because there's life in my wrist. So you gotta think the drive, right? What's the drive? You guys heard it now. Shoulder to elbow, elbow to the wrist. But the wrist must turn, okay, to the point of contact. In this case, you're always gonna get it, since you have no play with an opponent yet, you wanna get to the palm of your hand, backside of the palm of your hand, either the left of it to the right of it. That's where you play from. Okay? So basically, it's like a snake. Those are your four plays of your wrists. So when you're floating, you float from the backside of your wrist. When you turn your hand, you're going to turn from the center of your point and you're going to turn so your palm floats up. Don't turn so it looks like it's dropping in your elbow. If you turn where you're dropping elbows, where does my energy look like it's going? Here. Where does it look like it's going? It looks like it's going to my elbow. Did I have my elbow going to my wrist? No. I broke my forward intent. I broke my 3 points of drive. So when you do this, your elbow is going to support that wrist by torquing because of the wrist, and it's laying just behind it so the wrist can get the energy to drive up and forward. So it's very important that you do that. So if Hector does this, and he turns his hands, okay, let's do this so you can see better. And so if he does this, and I don't want you to feed your wrist, I just want to turn your wrist. So from here, once you turn your wrist, when you do this, don't feed it into your wrist. So if he just turns his hands, but he has no wrist energy, he'll feel like a fall. The other thing is do what I did where you just drop an elbow to the palm of the sky. If you do that, it'll go there. It's very important that you drive from there to there and turn the energy in the you draw it to your fingers. Gotta get to your palm. So turn and get it to your palm. So drive the energy into your palm. So that's what you want to do. So if we're like this, the test that you guys want to do if you have a partner, so I would just put his fingers on you, and as he turns, try to push his palm down. The reason why I don't want you to grab with the whole hand, because you might overpower and he doesn't have the skill to send the energy. Okay, if he does have the energy skill like this, and I have to push my palm down, so like this, you should be able to do this. Shouldn't be a problem, okay? However, if I lack skill, of course you're gonna break, because you can't handle the pressure yet, because your technique's not there yet. Once you learn how to drive your energy right, your technique right, you can handle a lot more pressure because your structural integrity is going to be higher. And when structural integrity is higher, you can handle more pressure. Okay? Right now, your structural integrity might be low, so you're not going to handle a lot of pressure. So you got to work your way up. You got to develop the energy control. Okay? So when we turn our hand, okay, you're going to turn the wrist from the center of the palm, and you're going to focus torquing. So when you torque your wrist, don't move your elbow, okay? How did I get his elbow to go inside the body? So if you look here, see his elbow? I'm going to torque the wrist. How did I get the elbow to turn inside the body? I use the wrist to turn that in. At the same time, he's supposed to drive that towards the elbow and then feed that up. That's how he gets his energy to go to the palm. He must keep his constant drive to the shoulder of the elbow, drive the elbow to the wrist, and the wrist must turn to the point of contact. In this case, it's going to turn up to the sky. So it's very important. One, when he does this, he turns, so he has to have his drive. Because if he loses his drive, don't drive. Drive your elbow to your wrist to the elbow. He will not be able to sustain pressure. He's going to struggle. He's going to stress. Okay? He's going to strain because he doesn't have proper structure. The stress level, if he does it right, he can feel stress, but he'll handle it because his structural integrity is high. Okay? So very important when you do this. Your palm is going to turn the center from the center point, which we call the Dan Pien, it's your energy point. He's going to pivot from the center, torquing the wrist, turning the elbow to support that by the torque and drive. Okay? Now, very important that you guys don't wind up doing this. Okay? That's committed energy. You're overextending. We don't want that. You want to be on point. Okay? You notice they can do this. Excuse me. We want to have forward energy, not committed energy. Forward energy is energy coming from our core out to where it is we're trying to get to. For example, my palm right now. That's forward energy. Committed energy is forward energy out of balance. It's when you're off balance. Remember the two things I talked about. You must have forward intent, but you also have to balance. Without balance, you'll overcommit. So we want to have both forward intent with balance. So here, you can see, I'm not throwing my body. But if I do this, I try to get that, that becomes committed. So we don't want to do that. So you got to watch out for that. Okay? Okay. So now that we have our turn, okay, your elbow should sit to support that wrist. So basically, if you look, I have an alignment. Okay? And I have that palm, right? So you don't want to look like this. But don't look like this, too. That's an alignment. That's overkill on the other side. Okay? It's like walking on a tightrope. I don't want to fall left, so I just lean to the right. It doesn't matter. You're going to fall. Okay? You want to find your line. You want to find that right point. So once we're here, we want to turn our hands. The palms have to face up, okay? Right, the next step is you're just gonna close your hands, okay? So your hands just create a closure. Now when you close your hands, I always like to say, don't make angry fists, okay? You don't hear, all you wanna do is just take your fingers and just have a natural roll. First finger comes in, middle finger comes in, or knuckles, I'm sorry. First knuckle comes in, middle knuckle comes in, and just kind of close it to the top half of your palm. You don't want to bring it to the bottom half of your palm. You can't close your hands. Okay, you just want to rest it so it just the thumb can naturally place over and just form a fist. Don't make a fist. Okay? Because you got to understand, fists should not be tense. Tension takes away some of your energy, slows you down, it telegraphs you. So we don't just want to form a fist. Don't create a tight fist. Okay? So just close your hands, and that's it. So your hands from this position at the rise just closes, okay? And then you just take your hand from there and you just draw back, okay? And I'm gonna break that down to you, okay? So when we do a draw back to the horse stance or to our sides, okay? We don't want to do this, okay? You see I'm swinging and I'm rising. Does that look like I still have the energy here? Or did it look like I'm driving it back and forth and up, right? So you want this from this position here and still look like it's still here. The play should be your elbow should be pushing, or shoulder should be pushing down the elbow. It should not be rolling up the shoulder from the elbow. Your shoulder still has to push down to the elbow. See, I'm pushing my shoulder down to the elbow. Okay, now my wrist or my elbow should still push to my palm, but your hand is going to turn to the elbow. So I have this pushing, pulling feeling in my elbow from my elbow to my palm because my elbow wants to push, but my wrist has returned. So you see, I have that push but return. So I am. Push the elbow, but the wrist is gonna turn. You see how that turns back? So you see the motion, I'm gonna push and turn, you can see? So that energy is not swinging up, it's driving the elbow, but also driving to the fist. So you wanna have that. So never go like this, because that's pressure going in. You're training yourself to let energy in. We're training the energy always forward, okay? So we don't want this upward, backwards feel, okay? We want this upward, in front of me feel. So it looks like it's still here. To do the test, okay? Pressure test control time, okay? So if I do this, so come over this way, Hector, please. Okay? If I do this, if Hector has put his palms on me, if I'm like this, can you push me backwards? Of course you can. You can actually see that. Okay? So if I'm here and pushes backwards, you can see it's a lot more difficult for him. So I can sink my body and go into like this and sink the root, and he will have a hard time because my energy's here. Okay? So that's the pressure test to make sure that's here. The other pressure test that we want to have is in the elbow. So if I'm like this and I go this, can you hold me? And I go, do the pressure look like I'm driving down or it went up? Hold me. I want to drive down. I want to keep that so my wrist turns. So you can see that power. And the purpose of this is obviously you can see the intent of here. That's your strike. Okay? It's very fast, very powerful. It's very easy once you learn to use your wrist. I suppose, sure. It's tough. And he loses his ability. And same thing driving forward with this, the elbow, because that's your hit. Okay? So you can see the purpose. It allows us to play with different levels of moving energy now. Okay? So it's very important that when we do this, okay, your hand from that position here and you close, okay, you don't want to do this either. Or this. Okay? Now, I know there are schools that say, oh, you want to bring up your ribs. You want to hang it down to your hips. That's fine. That's their style. That's their way. That's not the anatomical energy way. Okay? If you do pressure tests, you'll see that they cannot hold nothing here. And you can see their energies go back in the shoulder. You should have that rested shoulder feeling. Your elbow should always, or your shoulder should always drive to that elbow. Your elbow should always drive the wrist. And the wrist must always turn to wherever the directional force it wants to go. So you have that. And when you're done, you should be about your floating ribs. Somewhere along there, okay? It should be sitting just between there. Your elbow should be level of the wrist. It shouldn't be higher, because when it's higher, you're creating an imbalance in energy. So now you have a propensity that someone can bring it here. Someone can swing it now. If you go lower, obviously someone can pull it. And you can see if we do this, okay? If I tell them to go hold it high, right? And don't let me bring it to your face. Don't let me pull it down. He's hold it level. Don't let me push it to your face. Don't let me pull it down. It doesn't affect him as much, okay? Because he's creating what we call the imbalance. His body is strong one side, but guess what? Where it's strong one side is inversely weak the opposite side. And so if I attack him when he's strong, of course I can't take him down if he's stronger than me. Okay, so I might not be able to pull him down this way. Let's say he's strong enough to hold, so what, I shove it in his face instead. I'll attack him on his weak side. I may not pick his arm up, let's say, from here, because he's so strong. Well, I'll just take him down. Okay, so keeping your balance the best is the best way, because then you can adjust to changes. So like, well, what if this guy fail? Well, I'll adjust. So what happens is like this. If he's trying to push my left palm more, then I'll just this. And I'll just go like this. If he pushes this side, I'll just adjust. That's all. I'm going to keep balance as a standard point, not as the only point. Okay? Balance is a concept we want to keep at all times, but it doesn't mean it's 50-50. If we're 50-50, that's balance. If he pushes, say, it's 70% this side, 30%, then I'll go 30, and I'll go 70. I'm balancing with him. So I'm always adjusting according to what he's giving me. Okay? That's how we keep our balance. So you want to make sure that in this case, since you don't have an opponent, it's your elbow driving forward towards the wrist, okay? But the wrist turning back to the elbow. That's how we keep the balance. Okay? And again, if you have a person that you can practice pressure test with just a finger, actually, or a thumb, whatever, I should be able to just put it on his hand. And if he has that right drive down, drive forward, I'm not gonna be able to push it. But pull up a little bit like this, and don't let me. It's nothing. It's really nothing. The same thing the opposite way. If I had him do it this way, the right way, and he has that drive, his wrist turns back to the elbow, if I go like this, he could just twist that wrist into the arm and just drive it. But if he raises his shoulders, he'll see that it's nothing. Okay? So it's very important, like I said, that rule, the three drive rule, it's your fundamental basis of really learning how to both defend and attack. Okay? Is your play to adapt to all different types of energy, all different types of attack, and even your grappling ability will lay within that principle. Okay? So we want to have that principle, okay, in mind all the time when we play. Here, here, here. And you see my wrist is like, how do I turn? Well, when I'm here. When you make the fist, it's a twist. See my thumb come out a little bit? So it's twisting like this. So I want to have that twist, twist it in. So when you're playing your palm, twist, twist. Twist, 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 twist. You wrist it. Okay? And if you guys don't have it, this is the method of developing it. It's just jerk motions. Okay? here. Jerk motions will help you to find it. It'll help you to get it. So if you're like, man, I'm doing this for like 10 hours every day and I still feel like I got it, jerk motions will help you. It will get you there. Okay? It's one of the methods that I did to help feel for my whether I was off or not, every single little tiny motion. Am I right? That little jerk tells me, because if I go in motion, I get, I was off. I jerk. I set myself and allow myself to reset so I don't create momentum as my means of movement. I don't create straining or stress in the body as my means of movement. So we want to create that. Jerk motions, if you guys don't feel your energy yet, jerk motions will help you. Okay? Okay. The next stage is basically, okay, the sinking into the ground. Remember highest heaven, lowest earth? So once we create the pull in here, right? Remember, the shoulders drive the elbow drives the wrist turns the point of contact. The next stage you want to do is, you just want to bend your knees to where they touch. That's it. So you can see in a profile, okay? You want to bend your knees to where they touch. And that's such a height. Now, why do we do that? Okay, first off, most people's legs, if they stand right, they shouldn't touch. Some people are like, oh, my knees touch, I got thick legs, that's okay. Just bend your knees to where you feel pressure between your bones and your knees, okay? Some people have thick thighs, like, wow, when I stand like this, my legs are just touching all the time. Just bend it. Just bend it to where you feel the pressure on your knees, on the two knees just hitting each other. And that's fine, okay? So why do we do that and sit that way? Because we want to find our root. We want to find the ability to sink into the ground. Okay, and when we do this, the way we stand, if this represents my feet, you do not want to put your weight this way. You don't want to put it bowed. You don't want it here. You don't want it here. You want it straight down. You understand? So we don't want to stand like we're, okay, like this. We want to feel between the front ball to the heel, from the sides of the foot, to feel an even distribution of pressure. When we bend our knees, when we set our height, we want to feel the feet come to the ground. Okay, you want to feel that. So if I go like this, if I go like this, I'm going to rock back and forth. Okay, so we don't want, excuse me, we don't want to lean, slouch this. So if you're like this and you go like this, you can feel yourself fall forward, that's no good. You want to find yourself so you can sit, bah, and you set yourself nice and easy, okay? The other reason is, you know, in combat, you're not really supposed to stand straight up like this, fight like this, okay? You don't have a connection to the ground, you don't have a good drive. You don't have a good drive, you won't have good power. You want to have ground. You need the ground to generate power. Can you imagine floating in space and just staying still and you're trying to strike someone? How do you go forward? How do you get forward momentum? You can't, you need something to push off to get your power. So we need to bend our knees. We need to sink into the ground to get our power. In this case, you're finding your ground, your root, okay? You're gonna find the sinking of the knees so you can get your root. Set the height that you gotta in combat, you're gonna set yourself to. So you can see, you know, I would, come on, I would sink into the ground. I would find that because it allows us to give us a spring to go from like here, come forward, allows us to push off. So that root gives us the ability. So if I'm tall, I'm gonna lean if I'm tall because I don't have a lot of pushing power because I'm too high. So I don't really have a good friction to the ground. So I'm gonna wind up throwing my weight to get myself to move faster. And that's not good because you're off balance. Remember, we're all about the balance, we're all about the forward attack and the control. So we don't want that, okay? So we want to find the root. So bending your knees, feeling the ground is to get that ground for you, okay? So once you have that ability, okay, you find that bend and you have your arms rested to the side, remember, forward drive, right? Shoulder, elbow, upper wrist, turn the point of contact. You're going to just Now, there are two ways people argue about, you know, and sometimes, oh, this is right. Oh, really? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You don't fight like this. Okay? This is just a stance. Okay? So if you want to open up your feet, where you go, picking up the front ball, turning, and then turning the heels out, that's fine. Okay? If you want to take your circle step, that's fine. Both are fine. If you have a discipline to do that, that's great. Okay? If you've never trained, okay, the two ways that you have is, like I said, picking up the front ball, turning out 45 degrees, then picking up the heel, and then turning out 45 degrees outward. Okay? By the time you're done, your heel should be about the width of your shoulders. The key is making sure you're finding the ground between the front ball and the heel and the sides to side, that they are evenly distributed. The other way is bending your knees, shifting your weight to the right leg by picking up the left heel, yeah, and just make a circle out to where it's comfortable for you to swing out. Notice I did it without moving my body. Don't go like this. Just go like this. Okay? I would point the toe out, and we've marked this before to show you how you can see the angles. So once I cut that angle, I just want to turn my foot out to where it looks straight, shift all my weight on that leg. I'm going to draw my leg behind me, next to me, in front of me, and back to where it was originally. And I sit back in the center, and that's my horse stance. Okay? Why the argument of which one? You know, styles do both ways, so it doesn't matter because you're just standing. Theory-wise, why does Wing Chun do this way? A lot of people believe this because back in the days, okay, women wore dresses. They couldn't stand like this. They couldn't bring out their legs because their dresses were slender. They were slipped down to their knees, and so they could only open their feet up while keeping their knees in. And that's why Wing Chun is supposed to have taking these small stances and moving tight, moving this way, okay? But today, women don't wear tight dresses. They can wear jeans. They can wear long dresses. It doesn't matter. Men used to practice taking longer stances, hard stances. It doesn't matter. Like I said, you're arguing over nothing. You're arguing over whether one tomato is redder than the other. You know, it's like, who cares? It's a tomato, okay? So the most important thing is finding your root to the ground with your feet. Connecting to the ground. And the reason why we want to connect to the ground is that's how we generate our power to move forward, backwards, or sideways. And or sideways, I would say. Okay? So we have to have root. We have to find the ground so we can learn to basically move fast. Okay? We also have to have ground because then we can also learn how to move energy from the ground to the opponent through our arms or from the opponent's energy from our arms to the ground. That's our means. That's how we move energy, okay? So we wanna make sure that we have that proper ground feeling. So whatever one you do, okay, I'm just pick one. I'm not saying that, hey, this has to be it. I'm just pick one, okay? Just feel your knees bend. They should sit just above your front ball. If you go too far, you're gonna find that you're gonna lift too high. If you sit back too much, oops, I fell. You want to feel the root between the heel, the front ball, find your center, and you should feel very, very stable at that point. And everything from there, you have to learn from the ground, and then the rest of the forms, and the rest of the movement, you're learning how to drive. You're learning to move. So when he's like, say he wants to push me, let's say, I'm not going to rely on using the body. I have to rely and use my hands. So it's just pushing me. I learn how to use my hands without trying to throw my body. Okay? So not to say we can't use our body, but we have, if we don't have the ability to use our hands right and we throw our body behind it, it's ineffective anyways. It's gonna wind up committing and it's not as effective. Power comes from what we call rooting of the body that connects from here to the ground, from the ground back and into the opponent. And that's the importance. That's why we train, okay? That's all we're gonna get to do today. Like I said, it's gonna go in so much detail. It's gonna take a while to go through the form. Might even take longer than 10 months. might take 18 months. Okay. But I'm not going to cut it short for you guys so I can save time. We'll go through this and we'll take however long. If it takes us 3 years, it'll take us 3 years. Gosh, I'm so on camera. I'm kidding. I hope you guys really enjoyed it. I hope it helped you guys out a lot to see what energy is all about. Most of it is everything is based off what you see now. Same principle, same way. It's not going to be like, you know, one time we're going to take our shoulder, we're going to pull it backwards because that's the way the move works. No, the fundamental principle is all the same, like numbers. When you add, subtract, divide, or multiply, the fundamental principle of math is the same. It's universal no matter where you go. And so is energy. It's the same no matter where you go. Okay? So do you guys have any questions for me? I'm here to help you for the next 3 minutes. I'm kidding. 30 minutes.
Yeah.
My English not so good.
We do have a couple of questions too, let's see. Stonehaven asks, is there a benefit to either slightly pigeon-toed versus the feet parallel?
Well, for women, it's easier to do pigeon-toed because the hips are naturally more rounded, so it's easier for them to stand that way. For a guy, it's a little harder. I don't like the pigeon-toed because it stresses the knee if you do it a long time for a guy because their hips aren't made to curve as easy. So I prefer to do a straight leg. I don't like the pigeon-toed myself. I'm going to say, hey, this is my opinion, okay? You can stand pigeon-toed if you have a wider hips, okay? But me, I don't have wide hips. Okay, I got a 32-inch waist, so it's not that wide, okay? So standing like this over long periods of time, after a while, I feel the stress going to my knees. So it's myself. I don't like it, and I don't like anything that strains the joints to the point where it aches. Strain the joint to where you feel burn is fine, but if it aches, it's not good, okay?
Amit also would like to know, he said, where should all the weight be when the root is correct?
Centered.
How will we know that it's correct?
Didn't I just say, were you not listening? Oh my gosh. Heel, front ball, side to side, even distribution. Right? Okay. So when you're feeling the ground between your heel, your front ball, your left and your right, you want to find that even distribution. You don't want to favor to the left, to the right, the front, the back. You want to feel it straight. And if you do that on both sides, your body's going to naturally center itself.
He also would like to know if you can demonstrate that with having Hector push on you, rooted versus not.
Oh, okay. When you do like, what do you mean, not rooted?
Yeah, he wants to see it, but it's like, you know, if you're not rooted properly.
Like you're forward, backwards.
Well, to do that, it's also about the hands too. So it's not just, when you say about that, it's not just about the feet. It's about the hands into the feet. And the rooting is for example, Hector puts his hands on me like this, and I'm just gonna use a fist for now, okay? And if I go like this, do I look rooted or do I look like I'm off balance? I look like I'm off balance. So if he pushes, just put one leg in front of me so you get more power. And I go like this, you can see I'm not really connected. So I'm compensating my lack of root by throwing more weight to get more force forward. To get root, okay, you could be bowed, you'd be a cat, even horse. It's like into the ground, getting your drive. So when he pushes, it's just about getting that drive and the connection. So here, you can see he's straining for it. Okay? And do you see me leaning? Do you see me throwing more? No. Anytime I feel more power, okay, and I'm not going to add more power to him, okay? So, well, if that's the case, wouldn't you always feel the pressure? No, because we can turn the power. So if he's pushing into me, I can turn his power off. Okay, so I can use that as a tap. But for now, for demonstrative purpose, anything I feel here will go here eventually. But if I don't have a good root, it went to my back. And it hurts. So it's got to go from wherever my contact point is. If he grabbed me here, same difference. He's pushing me. See, it went to my shoulders. Here, do it again. Ba-ba. Now he goes into the ground. You can see it driving to my rear leg. Okay, so I'm able to take any force, connect my body, bring it to the ground. And then I can take it from the ground and bring it back to my opponent by using kind of contortion techniques, which is what the wrist job is supposed to do. Okay, hope that answered your question. And I only made fun of him because he's my student. So, who's found me on the line?
All right, we have Kirk. This is on the opening. When I bring my fist back to my side, my hands are already turned up. So do I keep twisting my wrist?
Yes, twist the thumb side, like I said.
Right.
So turn the thumb. So you always have that turning feeling into that.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. So when you're like this here, and you're like this, okay, I can't make a fist with this one because it's bad. But when you're here, you should be pulling at that point, you see? You don't go and then close. You would, when you learn, you will blend it all. Okay? Because there's no stop motion. I did teach you in stop motions. I should have told you should blend it. I should have said that. I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you that. But I was breaking it down so much detail, I forgot to tell you. Eventually, you blend everything. You don't pause and stop at every motion. So you would really go like this here, from the opening, you would really just more or less go like this into that point. I just broke it, I forgot to tell you that. Yeah, you wanna blend it all together, my bad.
Dan Lewis says, super detailed breakdown, thank you, Sifu. We have a few questions. Do we square our shoulders or just let them sit slightly forward?
No, you should square your shoulders.
Okay. And also, do we draw our fists level and parallel to our waist or keep them tucked on the higher hips, narrow at the fist and wider at the elbow?
Will you? Do you not speak English? Remember I said, when you sit, they should be around your floating ribs. Your elbows and your wrists should feel horizontal to the ground, or horizontal, I should say. If you practice on a hill or something like that, you know, you're not gonna, it's gonna be horizontal, okay? So you want that from the elbow drive out from there back. So it should be a horizontal level playing field. Your point should be around your floating ribs. Okay? Did I not say that?
I might have.
I might not have. I'm getting old. I'm losing it.
Let's see. Another person says, when you enter the rooting stance, where should your head be positioned?
Okay. Forgot to go about that one too. Highest heaven, lowest earth. Remember? Highest heaven. So you want to imagine a string on the back side of your head, not the top side of your head, the back side of your head. So imagine that's going to pull your neck like this, and it's going to bring your chin slightly. You do not want this. Want a slight pull. Or the best example I can say that I've heard before and I like and I use is imagine when you were in school and they measured your height, what did you try to do? So as tall as you possibly stand to get to seem like you're the tallest. That's exactly what I want you to think. Just imagine, always measure my height. Well, I want to stand tall. So you want to stand as tall as you can possibly stand, and your head will naturally, you think, oh, get the highest point I can get. That'll naturally set for you.
Brother Ashley has a question. He says, when a real fight takes place in the rooting principle, is that just basically moving from one rooted position to another, always seeking a place to root?
Yes. Rooting doesn't have to be two legs. Rooting can be one. Okay? You can stand on one leg and be rooted. You don't have to have two. Two is so you can transfer. You can start to learn to what we call toe, transfer the energy. Okay? The transfer of energy. So when we're talking about rooting, it's the concept that anytime you take a step, you know how you can get from one point to the other. So if I go into a calf stance, I have my root from the front ball to heel and the front ball. So if I want to move forward, I can dig the front ball in and root myself back down. I can push for a ball and root myself back down. You should always find a root at some point. You should never, like, for example, fight with both toes because you'll find that you'll lose balance, tippy toe. You'll find that under pressure, it'll knock you backwards. You need to have one foot down at all times so you can get the root. The other one can be what we call the stabilizing leg, okay? And that is what keeps you stable so you don't rock forward. It'll send the energy into the front balls that you can use to either push or push from the air and use as a break. So rooting is something you want to have at all times, unless you're fighting on the ground. Then you don't have to put your feet all the time to the ground, okay? You put a knee, you put a front ball, you put your elbows, and other points will be rooted for you.
We have one more question. Mercy asks, my right wrist has structural issues. Basically, it's very stressful when the palm is facing down, elbows in, to point my fingers straight up. If everything else is correct, is it okay for the fingers to be pointed outward?
What do you mean by outward? Like? Tell them to say, type yes when I go to the right angle.
Yeah, if you can see or hear this, Marcy, if you could let us know if we're doing this
fingers
right.
Are.
But he's talking about when the palms facing down, elbows in, to point
this.
The fingers straight up is difficult. So.
You don't. Out or up?
Outward.
Forward is what you want.
Right, but
okay.
Apparently that's.
Okay, if it does, listen.
So I think maybe more like this is.
Yes, okay, that's fine. That's fine. Because it's really not your fingers that matters. Because look, I can hold it like this. I want you to push my chest if you can, okay? So just give me a push. Ready? Go back, left, back. Bend your arms and push me. Oh, no, harder. So give me a push. Okay? So look, see my hand? Go ahead. Oh. Has nothing to do with your fingers. It's about your wrist, remember? I could do this, do it again. And it works the same. So you see, it has nothing to do with really your fingers. It's really your wrist and your arms. Our fingers are for steering and guiding. It's really not for driving power, okay? Unless your fingers stab it, that's another story. We're not gonna talk about that, okay? But mainly, if you use your arms to both deflect and attack, you don't need your fingers. They're there for stabilizers and assistance, but they're not there to drive power. So you could, if your fingers are more like this and it hurts you, that's fine. As long as you can understand to get your drive and know how to turn the wrist. So if you were like this, like, okay, my fingers, like, I don't know if you can tell, but I can't close my hand past this. I jam my finger really, really, I hurt my finger really, really bad. I can't close it like this. So I don't need to, see? I can do this.
Still.
I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. Does that change the structure of my arm? I do this. Ooh. Doesn't change anything. Okay? The structure of the arm is what matters. And the drive of the energy, that's what matters. Remember, it's your wrist job to turn the difference. So it's not the fingers job. So it's really irrelevant.
Danny has a wanted to rephrase his question. He said, thanks for answering, but he apparently did not state his question properly. What he meant to ask was, while looking at my forearms from the top view, do I parallel my arms left and right to my body like rail tracks, or should I bring my fist in a bit like a triangle?
I gotcha, Danny. Unfortunately, you only get one question per webinar, so I can't answer that. Okay. No, when you do this, you should be turning, so it should go straight like railroad tracks. You should not be going like this, because you're losing your forward and back drives. Here, forward back drive. Okay? So yeah, that would be a parallel train tracks. Okay?
And that's it. That's all we have.
Okay. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed it. I hope it helped a lot. If you guys enjoyed it, you know, next month we're going to continue this webinar series and get into the opening of the hands, develop the punches, and we're going to talk about that, how the body works. So if you guys enjoyed it and you know someone who has trouble with what they're practicing in, and let them know about what we're doing, that could help them. Okay? We're here to help you guys as always. Thank you very much for coming and watching. Any other questions? Any news we need to say?
I'd love to know if they haven't got a free ebook and Friday video course. They can check that out at innershaolin.com/ebook. I put that link in the chat for them as well. And if they want to check out Inner Shaolin, they can go to innershaolin.com/join.
Okay.
Sounds like a woman app.
I have long hair, so I look at one. But what she said. Okay. So we have a link for you if you guys are not a member. You want to learn more and see more, entershaolin.com. We have 5 free day video for you all about energy, how it works, how our body works with energy. Ebook that we wrote for you, what about energy in our body and concepts and principles of energy in the NoDecNo system. So just come, it's free. We'd love to hear from you guys. If you guys really enjoyed it, spread the word, let us know what you thought. And you know, your comments we listen to, and we like to get better, and we only get better because of you guys. Okay, thank you very much, guys.